Hi guys, in this video we're going to talk about one of the most important and common practices in shader development, using world coordinates instead of UV coordinates to map a texture on geometry. Usually we use the mesh UV coordinates, which can be visualized by connecting them to the emissive color pin. The gradient displayed on the mesh is the result of UV values interpreted as color information. From here, you can see in practice the correspondence between the vertex UV coordinate and how it's colored. The more a vertex is on the right side of the UV quadrant, the redder it is. The more on the bottom, the greener. To make a texture world-aligned, we have to use two of the vertices' world position components as UV coordinates. In a real engine, this is done by taking the world position node and masking out one of the three components. As you can see, we now have a very strong separation within colors, instead of a nice gradient like before. Also, the emissive is generating quite a lot of light. This happens because a unit in a real engine is 1 cm long, so our workspace UV quadrant also is. To fix this issue, we can scale the world position values inside the shader, for example by dividing it by 100 units. In this way, I made my UV quadrant 1 meter per 1 meter long. To visualize the UV quadrant, the frac node can be used. Now, we can better observe that the color is not dependent anymore from the vertex position inside the mesh UVs, but on its position in the world. The more I move the object along the x-axis, the redder it becomes. The more I move it along the y-axis, the greener. If I move it on the negative side of the axis, it becomes black, since there's no way of displaying negative light, but the values are there indeed. As you may have noticed, right now the texture is mapped on the horizontal plane. This is because, by default, the component mask node has the X and Y axis checked as outputs. If I change which axes are selected, I change the plane on which my texture is projected on. With this method, I can project my texture on any plane orthogonal to any axis I desire. Moreover, with some additional math, it's possible to create world UV coordinates along a custom plane. You can think every position of the geometry surface as the tip of an arrow that starts from the center of the world. It is, in fact, a vector. When we world-align a texture, we are considering as UV coordinates all those vectors, after being projected on the chosen plane. In the previous examples, all the projection math was simplified in just getting rid of one of the vector components, since doing that is equivalent to squeeze a vector on the plane that sits on the remaining two axes. If you want our projection plane to be inclined at, let's say, 45 degrees, we can't do that, since there isn't a single axis that we can strip away to obtain the coordinates anymore. If we first rotate all the position vectors in a way that one of the new transformed axes coincides with our projection plane normal, we can again strip away one axis and have our custom UV coordinates. So, how do we do that? Luckily, a real engine provides a lot of ready-made functions that cover all the most common complex operation we usually have to do. In this case, we need the transform to z vector function. The vector to transform is the word position, and the z vector is a constant tree vector, which will identify the projection direction. Since we are generating new UV coordinates, we could consider the option of moving all these operations to the vertex shader. Depending on the context, this action could also bring some performance advantages with it. For example, if we are going to use this shader on very large planes, by moving to vertex shader, these instructions will be executed only for 4 vertices per plane. Instead of all the screen pixels, such planes are occupying. So, let's add a custom UV pin and plug all the nodes in there. Now, as UV input for the texture sampler node, we will need the text chord node, which will output our custom UV values. To have a better grasp on what we just did, you can follow my previous video, which contains a basic shader structure introduction. With the texture set in place, let's take a look inside the scene. Everything seems working just fine, but watch what happens if I rotate the geometry. The light on the object behaves in a weird way, like it's hitting the surface from the wrong angle. Problems like this are usually caused by incorrect normals. Let's take a look at the word normal buffer. As you can see, by rotating the plane, the normals are changing color instead of remaining coherent. This happens because the shader samples them in tangent space, but we are doing our math in workspace. To fix this problem, we have to recompute the geometry tangent basis by using the derived tangent basis node. This node will rotate our normal map vectors in the right direction, in workspace. Now, to complete the work, we have to choose between two options. Set the whole shader to work in workspace, or leave the shader in tangent space and transform the node output. This choice depends on the context. If the shader will work mainly with workspace coordinates, it's better to choose the first option, which also uses less instructions overall. In this video, we'll focus on this first choice. The shader can be set to work in workspace from this panel. To better visualize the difference between a corrected normal and one that is not, here is a geometry that recomputes the tangent basis only on the right side of the screen. On the left side, the normals are not following the geometry inclination, which, as explained before, is the cause of incorrect lighting in the scene. Workspace mapping is the foundation of many different shading techniques, which will be discussed in future videos.